industrial processes, as I pointed out in my video on the top 20 emitters. Making things like chemicals, materials, steel, and especially cement will be one of the hardest areas of the global economy to decarbonize. I was struck by the figure that up to 50% of the energy used in industry is lost as heat.
Waste heat recovery is broadly the category referred to try and capture that energy. If pipes aren't insulated, for example, or if you build a factory and later on you realize you need to build a new boiler, a new furnace, and you build it where you have space available, that might not be right next to the process where you actually need it. And so you have to take that heat or that energy and transfer it across the manufacturing complex where you are. Every inch you move that heat, you lose some of it. It's just, even with the best insulation in the world, it's very hard to transfer 100% of it. So better designing manufacturing facilities, better insulating. When electricity is produced, it's actually done by creating steam that then drives a turbine to generate electricity. But that steam can be captured and used for heating, though it's often not.
Another small thing, but when you pointed it out in the book, it kind of blew my mind. Like, oh, I never even think about motors in all these factories that make an assembly line work. How important it is to have that motor use just enough power to get the job done and not too much.
In recent years, a lot of industries have moved to variable speed motors, like what you're talking about. And that's partly due, by the way, to standards in the US, especially Department of Energy standards on motors. But in a lot of other regions and historically, they've just had fixed speed motors. And so those don't have the ability to ramp up or ramp down based on what they're actually needed for. It's actually amazing. You wouldn't think of something as like a small motor being so important, but it's had a huge impact on energy use in industry. China has one of the most successful programs in the world to address energy and emissions in industry. It's called the Top 10,000 program. And it's really a bucket of several different policies, ranging from things like worker training to energy audits and energy reporting. It's amazing, actually, when you require people to report how much energy they're using and where it's coming from, you help industries identify processes where they're using much more than they should. And that's helped drive huge reductions in energy use in China's industry sector, far exceeding the initial goals of the program. Providing those technical resources and in some cases setting those actual energy use requirements on industries, especially when you know that other facilities are achieving those goals, is a great way to drive industry to become more efficient.
So the United States has turned to natural gas instead of coal. Methane leaks are a huge problem. How are policymakers tackling this specific challenge?
There are different standards in different states. The Obama administration had a set of natural gas standards that have since been scrapped by the Trump administration. But monitoring is a big part of the issue. There's lots of miles of pipeline, and it's challenging and can be expensive for natural gas operators to monitor all of that. But without monitoring it, it's very hard to know the leakage rate and where the leakage is occurring if we don't have a better understanding of the system and being able to identify those leaks. And that covers the whole entire system, all the way from where the gas is extracted down to where it goes into people's homes. There's a fair amount of research on the transmission or like the large scale natural gas system. There's less on the distribution system, and there's even less on where the distribution system meets up with people's homes, you know, what's happening once the gas arrives, how much of it is leaking. And then there's requirements on capturing methane. So a lot of methane is actually just vented, even though natural gas manufacturers and refiners are promising not to do it. There's a ton of methane that's just being leaked because the other products that they're producing are more valuable. Methane is 28 times stronger than CO2 over 100 years. And so even just burning it is an improvement over letting it vent. There's something called green well completions, which make sure that when the wells go in, the gases that come out are captured and they don't just simply leak. Colorado has been a leader on this. And actually Canada has a set of standards for natural gas extraction that are pretty stringent.
Cement is a massive emitter. The whole process is very emission energy intensive. Are there policies that have achieved decarbonizing cement even a little bit? I think a little bit would go a long way given how much it's used.
A big one is something called cement clinker substitution, which basically means the cement process involves breaking down some inputs into material that can then be used as cement, but you can replace some of that from other sources such as ash or gypsum. Provided it meets certain criteria, you can increase the share of cement that's coming from those materials and therefore avoid the chemical process by which you have to make the clinker. Some industries are looking at alternatives for the energy used to create the cement. So exploring whether or not they can use indirect heat from electricity would be a big one. Reducing the demand for cement actually is another big one. So buildings in the US last 50, 80, 100 years. Buildings on average in China last 20 years. And so every 20 years, that building has to be replaced with new cement. And that's from a mixture of building codes. Sometimes the quality of the materials, the steel or the cement used, is not high quality, and that causes the building to kind of crumble. In the long run, cement is actually a good industry to target for carbon capture, because that process of turning the inputs into clinker that's used for cement, that actually produces CO2 as a pretty pure byproduct. And so if you can just capture that in storage, you don't have to deal as much with separating it, which is one of the big costs of carbon capture. My hope is that in the long run, cement might be a good candidate for carbon capture. There's an emerging group of people who think that something called cross-laminated timber, which is a new way of reforming wood products that makes them have almost the same strength as cement. It's not clear yet how large of the market for buildings can be met by that.
The full length, hour-long version of this interview is available to members of my new video on demand offering, tdc.video. If you found this interesting, you should definitely check that out. A premium membership not only gets you access to every full-length episode of the Climate Change Solutions Show, you help support this project and its goal of bringing these solutions to the attention of as many people as possible. Plus, you get access to my research links from each episode of this show to help you efficiently dig much deeper into these solutions on your own. Until next time, for TDC, I'm Bryce Plank. Thanks for watching.